Hi guys, I'm here today with Private Frank Ofelt. Frank?
How are you?
And we're at Fort Clinch, and Frank's gonna take us back in time so we can see what it was like in the day of the life of a soldier and Fort Clinch back in that era. Frank, thank you for meeting with us and kind of giving us an overview of what Fort Clinch, well, I'm gonna let you tell the story.
Okay, so Fort Clinch is a third system fortification, which was built for harbor defense, part of a plan of the United States government following the War of 1812 to better provide the protection of the country's major seaports and waterways. And when Florida became a U.S. territory in 1821, after that, the federal government tasked the Army's Corps of Engineers to survey and review Florida's coastlines, its major waterways. And they decided that there were certain places along the coastline here that needed to have a fort for harbor defense. And the north end of Amelia Island was an ideal spot to build a fort because it would allow the fort to guard over the Cumberland Sound, which is the access into the St. Mary's River and the Amelia River, which were vital commerce ports under Spanish and British rule, and then of course under American rule with Georgia being part of the 13 colonies after the War of Independence.
Gotcha, mm-hmm. Gotcha, okay. How many, so the soldiers here in the 1862, 63, 64 time period, they were basically engineers?
Yes.
And there were some infantry?
Yes, there were a number of infantry units that served on Amelia Island and Cumberland Island, and there also was an engineering unit, Company E, 1st New York Engineers, and Company C. They served on the island as well. They were tasked with the construction of Fort Clinch wartime. The fort had started in 1847 being built. 14 years of construction was done before the outbreak of the Civil War, but with the Civil War taking place, there was about a year over a year of construction that was not done. So when the Federal Army captured Amelia Island in March of 1862, they brought an engineering unit to try and move forward on the construction of the fort, to try and bring it to a completion. We're looking at about 5.5 million bricks here at the fort today, where the total count should be around 7 million bricks for completion. And that would allow for a garrison of up to 500 soldiers of battalion strength.
Wow.
To be stationed here. And they'd have 78 pieces of artillery. 57 of them would be the largest seacoast guns that were available to the Federal Army at that time.
At that time. Mm-hmm. So how many, let's say in 1864, approximately how many soldiers were stationed here at the fort?
Here at the fort is an average between 150 to 250 in and around the fort. About 100 to 125 were living in the fort site within the barracks building we're currently sitting in when it was completed by 1864. Outside the fort were wooden barracks buildings that were constructed by the engineers to give a more permanent environment for the troops to live in. They also had some small encampments, but most of the men lived in more permanent structures while the fort's buildings were being completed. And as they were completed, they would gradually move into them and take over them. And then, of course, down in Fernandina Town and over in Cumberland Island, the troops over there lived in buildings as well. The town, of course, had a number of homes and shops and businesses and churches, mm-hmm. which were occupied. You know, the Presbyterian Church down there, as well as St. Peter's,
yeah.
were both used as army barracks during
right.
the Civil War. Churches make great barracks buildings. They're big, they're roomy.
Yeah.
The congregation might not like them, but the congregation wasn't really meeting during the war when the Federal Army was
right.
here. They had all left
yep.
and evacuated when the Confederates pulled out.
Right. Now, you mentioned Cumberland Island. Mm-hmm. Was there a garrison over there? Was
yes.
there a fort over there?
There were batteries over on the island, and they made use of those. Those batteries were guarding the waterway, the inland coastal waterway here, intercoastal today. They had about roughly anywhere from 500 to 1,800 federal troops over on the island over there, and they basically were stationed there because the island is 13 miles long like we are here at Amelia Island and about 1 mile wide. It would allow for Southern forces, if they wanted to come down, cross the intercoastal, take up positions on Cumberland, and be able to monitor federal activity through the waterway, or try and affect the naval force going in and out, or even if they wanted to, if they could get heavy guns over there, they could bombard Fort Clinch here. However, by having a force, a security force over there, that kind of prevents that from taking place.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I've often wondered about
mm-hmm.
that.
Yeah.
The day in the life of a soldier.
Okay.
What time would their day start? What would it be like? You know, Take us through
that. Okay. Their day generally started at daybreak. They were up in the morning early. They had a series of military calls that they would follow throughout the day. So you had Assembly of the Musicians was the first call of the day. You knew when that was played by a drummer or a fife or even a bugler that you were going to be getting up in a few minutes because Reveille would be the next call. And then you have Reveille, you'd have fatigue call, you'd have breakfast call, call for sick call. That's where the sick, lame, and the lazy would show up. I don't feel good today, doctor or hospital
sick,
steward.
Sick, lame, and lazy, yeah. Okay.
And then they'd have guard mount as well. And they would work generally in and around the fort doing construction work, the engineers, while the infantry was the security force for the fort site. At noon, they would break. They would take in their dinner, which was their noon meal. And then after they've had dinner, they'd be back to work again till the late afternoon, where there'd be some company drills or formations. And then they'd have retreat, and then they'd have supper call, and then they would generally hear tattoo, which means lights out, and then later would be taps off to bed. What's really interesting is here at Fort Clinch is we got two lists of the actual calls, military calls of the day that the soldiers followed. One is an early call about April 1864, and one is in the fall. So you can also see where they've counted in for the time change or the early sunset.
The
day has changed some, yeah.
So they adjusted.
They're adjusting for that. It's interesting to see that. The change there, but they really had a regimented day that was filled of activities, and for the engineers was work around the fort site. In the period that the first New York engineers were here at Fort Clinch, they laid about 2 million, 2.5 million bricks here. So,
wow.
5.5 million here today. The greatest numbers here were close to completion. Need another million and a half more bricks. It is.
That's a lot of brick.
And the bricks here are coming from New York and Pennsylvania to the fort site, as well as New Hampshire granite, Pennsylvania sandstone, New York and Pennsylvania slate stone, all that being brought in. Here on the island, they're harvesting the trees for timber to be used in wood products at the fort, tables, benches, beds, shelving, so on, trusses for roofs and stuff like that. But also they're making tabby, which is an oyster shell concrete, commonly found along the coastal areas of South Carolina, Georgia, and Florida.
Yeah.
So they make that on site here.
I mean, you know, it's amazing because you can still see it today. Yeah. It lasts.
Oh, it's very durable. We got a house in town, the Tabby House.
The Tabby House.
Yeah, the Tabby House.
Go. Yeah. And you can still see the boards where they put the boards to put the tabby behind it. You know?
They build a bulkhead and fill that in, and then take away the bulkhead. And out here at the fort, once the bulkhead is removed, they brick face it.
Yeah.
So they hide the tabby because it's not a dress stone. Brick is very attractive. It's a dress stone. It looks good.
Yeah, it's more, it has that military appeal too. You
know? Very, very uniformed.
Were the soldiers well fed?
Yeah, they are well provided for. The accounts of the troops here at Fort Clinch was they were getting an abundance of food. They're getting meats. They have an animal stockade on the island where they're slaughtering cows and pigs. They mentioned that, the slaughter yards. They also are getting government contract agents that are buying dry goods, vegetables, and fruits and having them sent here to the island. The infrastructure of Amelia Island completely collapsed once the Southern forces had left it. All the shops, businesses, merchants were gone. Most of the town folks were gone, other than about 490 that stayed behind.
This
is 62 when the Confederates pulled out. So government contract agents were providing basically everything the town needed, as well as the army needed on Amelia Island and also here at the fort site. So flour, yeast, sugars, salt, pepper, coffee. Coffee was a staple drink in the Federal Army. And it's ironic that it's a staple drink, but they did not domestically grow coffee in the United States. It's all imported from the Caribbean and South American countries.
I don't think they still grow it here, do they?
Very little. I think the Hawaiian Islands have some coffee, you know.
Yeah.
But we're not getting any of that.
So did the Confederacy ever occupy Fort Clinch?
Yeah. For 11 months, they occupied the island and the fort site. And then General Robert E. Lee, the department commander, issued an order of evacuation in February of 1862. And the Southern forces on the island began withdrawing. They eventually made a complete withdrawal from the island here, as well as Cumberland Island. And on March 3rd, a Federal Expeditionary Force arrived here in force. 28 ships and roughly about 6,000 6,000 troops, and they took possession of Amelia Island and Cumberland Island. This area was critical to maintaining the naval blockade. The United States Navy could use the Port of Fernandina, good, calm water, good ship anchorage. Of course, you would know that, your family in the boat building business there and ships. And so they could use the waterway here to base the naval force that maintained the blockade from Fernandina south to Key West and Fernandina north to Hampton Roads. Matter of fact, Admiral DuPont, Samuel F. DuPont, he was the admiral in charge of the fleet, and his headquarters was here on Amelia Island in 62 and 63 and part of 64.
Really?
Yeah. It was in Governor Broome's house down on Broome Street.
Yeah.
Broome was one of our governors of Florida there, and so they occupied his house as the naval headquarters. Yulee's home, Senator Yulee's house here on Amelia Island, was Army headquarters for the Army forces on the island.
And that house is a what?
Yeah, it's across from the library there, on the back side next to Villas La Palmas.
Okay.
And the lot is there, but the home is gone.
We
have photographs of the home in the Florida collection, Florida Memory online, that show the house with the sentry boxes and everything where the soldiers would have stood duty. And there are many written accounts about, you know, his home being Army headquarters.
So, yeah, wow.
Making use of that house.
Wow. Now, the soldiers, getting back to them, for recreation, what would the, what, you know, give us a sense of what they would do for recreation.
They had they liked to nap when they could. They played, of course, board games, checkers and chess, dominoes, dice was very popular. They'd have competitive matches, rowboat races and shooting matches. They played rounders, which is a predecessor to baseball. They'd play that out here on the fort. They talk about that. They'd go shell collecting. They'd go fishing. Fishing was always an interesting thing, especially for some of these boys, because the first couple of times they caught flounders, they were astonished by this flat fish with the eyes on one side of the face and swam this way as opposed to like this. So that was kind of a novelty. Matter of fact, they were told by one of the medical stewards not to eat it, that they were freaks of nature and they'd get you sick. So that's kind of ironic that was going on. They entertained themselves. They also went to religious services. There were cotillions and social events put on by the various commissions that would come and visit the troops. Christian Commission, Sanitary Commission, Women's Relief Society. They were women organizations, male chaperone that would come to Amelia Island, and they would provide services to the soldiers, entertainment, religious tracts, put on gatherings where they would bring in hosting ministers to provide ministry services to the men. They would do letter things where they'd write letters for the soldiers. They'd also bring them things. Sanitary Commission was really big in providing assistance to the medical department, ensuring that they were getting the medical needs and supplies that were required to keep the men healthy. And so they were a big part of that. The Women's Relief Society, these lovely ladies were coming down visiting the troops. Now, the fort site was strictly an all-male garrison. No families here, not living in the fort site. They would put on cotillions, the Women's Relief Society, and so the soldiers would go to that. Later on in the war, we start seeing wives of some of the soldiers and officers coming to Amelia Island to visit. As the war progressed, it became more of a safe area and wasn't constantly under a threat of an assault, especially with the Southern Confederacy late in the war being kind of beaten back a little bit there.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, it's interesting. I mean, you know, you often wonder, you know, now, Old Fernandina was still...
Yeah, that was still a thriving town. Fernandina has two towns, old and new. The railroad is being built starting in 1858, and the town kind of moves, you know, that's thrown out to them. Listen, if you want to prosper and be a part of the railroad, then you need to move from where what we call Old Town Fernandina to what is now New Town Fernandina to be a part of the railroad, because they're not laying another mile of track across the marsh.
No.
Which is ironic, because they could have done that because they laid a trestle bridge across the intercoastal, which was like, what, 1,000 feet or something like that?
At least.
So, I mean, they could easily could have built it. They just weren't going to build it.
Yeah.
So the town kind of splits. The 1864 account shows that there are like 77 active residencies and buildings in Old Fernandina. You know, there was a church over there as well. And then, of course, there was the plaza site, which was the remnants of Fort San Carlos, which was built by the Spanish in 1817 as a fort to guard the town of Fernandina there. There was a battery there built by the Confederate forces and then continued by the federal forces. They had a two-gun battery of two 24-pound Seacoast guns over there at Old
Where
Town.
Where Fort San Carlos.
Yeah, where the bluff, out so there where the bluff would have been.
So what happened to it? I mean,
it eroded. Yeah, what had happened was over the years, the erosion and the widening of the Amelia River ate away the base of that bluff and it eroded into the river.
Into the river.
And so all we have now is the plaza site, which was kind of like the parade field area
parade
of the fort.
Field. I got you. Okay. All right. The I know they had horses out here, and you said mules.
Mules, yeah.
And I know that there was a wharf. You kept talking. Mm-hmm. You said that the ships actually came into a wharf, mm-hmm. and I didn't know that there was a wharf here,
yes.
you know, for the ships. And so yeah. tell us a little bit about the wharf.
So to ensure the items that were needed in the fort's construction, the government under Captain George Dunton in 1848, they started construction in 1847. It took them almost a year to clear the land here just to get the site ready. This was an all a forest, so all the trees, underbrush had to be cut out. But the other most important thing was the building of a pier to receive the supplies that were necessary in the fort's construction. The brick, the stone, the mortar, even timber, nails, iron, all of that had to be landed at the pier here at Fort Clinch. It had a major pier on the west side of the fort. And in my early days in the park here, you could go out there at the really, really low tide, especially, you know, when we have those full moons and the moon's right. on the other side of the planet and the tides are really out. Used to be able to see the tops of the pilings from the old pier that was down there. And so this was vital. Later on, they laid railroad tracks on the pier and installed a small train system, narrow gauge train system, to bring goods from the pier up to the fort site. And between us and the pier was, in the pre-Civil War years, before the Civil War, there was a construction community out there which housed the workforce, civilian workforce that was employed by the federal government working on the fort site. They had their own little community right there. So for those folks to be able to receive stuff that they might have ordered or expecting to come to improve their lives, we'd come to that pier right there.
Mm-hmm. You know, digressing, because you mentioned that, and it's interesting. I read a book, and I've been trying to think of the name of it, but it was about North Florida, but it was a family, and they had cattle, but the mother wanted a Dutch oven, and he kept asking the captains of all the riverboats for a Dutch oven, mm-hmm. and it took her like 4 or 5 years to finally get her Dutch oven.
Wow.
You know, and I got to find that book. A great book.
Being an island, of course, that is what we are, Amelia Island. Everything coming in to support the town prior to the building of the Florida Railroad comes in by ship or mm-hmm. by barge or mm-hmm. by rowboat to this island.
Yep.
Now, the Florida Railroad is unique, but it is an east-west, west-east rail line, not a north-south rail line. So the idea of that was to bring goods to Fernandina, ship them west over Florida to the west coast, Cedar Key, pick them up by ships and take them west and to the areas around the Gulf of Mexico, New Orleans, Alabama, Texas, and have ships avoid sailing around Florida. But with that happening, people could make orders of items, and it was coming in on those ships that were delivering those goods to be shipped by rail. So businesses were starting to prosper a little bit more because now they could carry Dutch ovens locally here. Hey,
the beginning
know.
Of Amazon.
Yeah, so I can order stuff right here and it'll be delivered right here to Fernandina. How about that?
Oh, technology.
Yeah. And
look at where it's yeah. gotten us today. I mean,
you know?
You can pick open up your iPhone today, order something, and in some cases, tomorrow it'll
yeah.
be here.
Yeah.
And
so it's really important. The island survived on transportation of goods by water, by ship, mm-hmm. and it shows it. Mm-hmm. You know, anything you would need. You needed tools, you needed rice. If you were growing a little bit of rice around, big rice plantations north of us here. Other stuff, any like anything you would need, you could possibly order and have it delivered and come to Fernandina.
And then you'd pick it up.
You'd go into the merchant and say, hey, can I have the catalog? I want to order this. Oh, okay, it'll be here in about 2 weeks or 3 weeks, you know. So, yeah, Dutch oven would be important. You could order
Yeah. That I've got to find that book. Yeah. That was a great book. But I've got to get that book to you because you've really
That'd be interesting.
I just can't think of the name of it or the author right now.
You know, today, of course, you know, we have a major bridge, the Shave Bridge coming over the island and everything, you know, a lot of stuff come in by tractor trail. But we still have a train operating here, so stuff still comes in by rail. But we also have a small port facility. So container ships still come in and offload things that we use here. And we also are shipping out things from here to Caribbean islands. And, and that's important as well. So we still have a little bit of that going on. I always was interested. I would have loved to have seen the Port of Fernandina at its hay time with all the ships and everything coming in and the different flags from different nations and the exporting of the timber and the importing of goods and all of that. It really, that's why it was critical for the Army to have a fort here to guard this major waterway. Yep. This was a major commerce port for the country.
I look at some of the old pictures, and of course, you know, this river is where I was born and raised, and, you know, our families building boats, and I myself, and, you know, I look at those old schooners, you know, the three, four, five-masted schooners that were in here, and I look at all the timber, and I look at the barrels of turpentine that were being shipped out of here, and I'm thinking, my gosh, man, I mean, what would it have been like back in those days?
Important enough for a decision to be made in Washington that a fortification should be built here. That shows how prized this port facility was, it and St. Mary's.
And geographically how important it was to our nation.
Absolutely.
That we all enjoy today. Frank, if you could tell a little bit about this beautiful treasure that we have here and, you know, tell us a little bit about it.
So, Fort Clinch State Park was created in 1935. The state of Florida acquired it. It's a CCC park under the WPA, President Roosevelt's New Deal. They did a restoration and establishment of the park, developed the campgrounds, walking trails, beach accesses, did restoration on the fort site to get it open as a historic site so folks could come out and tour it. The whole north end of Amelia Island is a state park. We have two active campgrounds, the beach campground, river campground. We have biking trails, hiking trails, nature walks at Willow Pond. You can see alligators out there. We got some really good fishing along the north end of the island here, especially around the fort side, shell collecting, finding shark's teeth, and then touring the fort. This is a really nice treasure to have this here and to be able to tour the site. It's a time capsule. You're seeing the fort as it was 1864 when the Federal Army occupied the site. You could tour through the buildings and you could really come to understand what it was like to be a soldier stationed here during one of the greatest conflicts in our country's history. That's the Civil War. Fort also served in the Spanish-American War and World War II, but also take in the park. This is a full day of activities out here and it's right here just on the north end of the island. Come by and see us. Take advantage of this great treasure we have, which is Fort Clinch State Park. We are, like I said, one of the first nine Florida state parks created. And we're open every day. Park hours are 8 a.m. to sunset, and the fort hours are 9 to 5 every day. Rain or shine, kind of like the post office, always always open. You know, I think they're closed on Sundays now or something. But, you know, hey, you just come by and see us. Take it all in. It's a great opportunity. You're looking to explore and do something, you have it here.
This is it.
This is it.
And it is. Folks, I got to tell you, I mean, even for old natives like me that, you know, it's been a long time since I've been out to the fort just to visit. But I got to tell you, Frank's right. I mean, we're in the barracks area right now, and I'm waiting on the soldiers to come in any time, you know, from the morning work and get ready for lunch. That's how authentic it is. So for you old timers like me, get reacquainted with Fort Clinch, and I think it'll really shock you what you're going to see. And for you newcomers, please, if you haven't been out here, take advantage of it. Come visit and look up Private Ofelt.
I'll be out here.
He can set you straight.
There you go,
Frank. Thank you
Much. Appreciate it. Hope they'll come see us.
We will. I definitely will be back. We definitely will come back.
Absolutely.
So with that, we got another great interview coming up with Frank at another date. And this one's going to be on the history of Nassau County and, you know, such things as David Uli and the train and the Cedar Key. So stay tuned for that. Until then, God bless.